with Tom Elam on one side and Steve on the other side, I sort of feel like an Oreo cookie. I'm not an economist, and but I would like to maybe preface what I'm going to talk about a little bit. And I saw a news clip on Monday, and it came from the UN Food Summit, and the statement was that every 5 seconds, a child dies of starvation in the world. That's 17,000 children per day. And I'm sitting here wondering why we're in the mess we're in and people are starving. But with that, I'd like to preface this conversation by saying that I wear three hats, and one is with Pine Ridge, but one is with BMI, which is a consulting group. And some of the packers in the United States and Canada, we have consulting arrangements with. Therefore, when you turn in your questions at the end of this, if you could not make it packer specific, that would be very good for me. Well, the goal of this presentation is to spend a little time on how we got here and how we get the hell out of here. Just a little history lesson, and you know, one of the things is sometimes you miss signals in your life, and that's probably the most important thing in agriculture and in business in general. I can remember a story when I was in high school, and really I had my first date, and we went to the drive-in theater, and we're sitting there, and the gal I was with said, "Hey, John, do you want to get in the back seat?" And I thought about it for a while, and I thought, no, I think I just need to stay up here with you. So I missed the signal. And when I look at the hog industry, I don't look at it just as production. I look at it as a packer and really all the way upstream. If we look at the perfect storm that happened to us, and Steve alluded to it, we had our feed costs change dramatically. The economy was in the pits. There's some slides later on that we can see all these things that happened. Our production gains were good. The circle virus was gone. H1N1 had a short-term effect on us. The supply was too great, and China stopped their export program. And so we followed all those signals to get to where the perfect storm happened. Well, okay, this probably of the presentation, this is the most important slide. Because I think this was a tipping point for animal agriculture in the United States. As we all know, ethanol wasn't a free market decision. It was political. And that one political move, if you look, I put the cutout, the average cutout, in around 70 cents, up and I put the average feed cost per pig, and we have taken pretty close to $30 margin out of that. And that's $30 that will it's with us for the rest of our life. That changes the dynamics of the whole industry. That changes the financing. That changes the packer outlook. That changes everything we're doing. Politics, only one other time in the history of agriculture that I can remember that we had a political event was the Russian grain boycott. And that event taught our neighbors to the south how to be a fierce competitor with us. But as we go through this whole presentation, as we go through how the packer looks at the system, this one tipping point is going to have the biggest impact on how we conduct our business going forward as partners in this food chain. Some of the things that are happening in the packer arena is that having upstream integration, and by that I'm saying people like Oscar Mayer and Bar S and some of the large further processors are integrating with the slaughter side of the business, and so that. So the slaughter side is becoming much more involved in further value-added products, either through acquisitions or through these linkages. if we think about that in today's world, or in, let's say in the last 5 years, if you looked at a totally integrated model, and the totally integrated model would be someone like PSF, if you look at at their financials and how their business was based, probably close to 70% of the revenue side of it was dependent on animal production, and 30% on value added or further processing. 5 years from now, that's going to be reversed, because these people are getting into more fully cooked products, they're getting into more case-ready products, and just all value-added products. Plus, at the same time, they're trying to establish brands. And that's really important from a producer's standpoint, because the producer, by being linked to the packer, can have a negative effect on the brand, or a positive effect depending on the type of genetics or the type of meat that you deliver to the packer. So as we go through this, we got to remember that what's going on in the industry right now is there's going to be more partnering, and it's going to be more important for the producer to be linked closer to the packer. So if you look at some of the great products that have been added. Hormel has got the shelf stable products. They've done a lot of R&D on how to control bacteria through high pressure treatment and all sorts of things. But they're putting their name on the product. And you've got Tyson, who is really now looking upstream more at how to add value and how to please that customer. A lot of packers, the changing role that looks like to me that's going on right now with packers is because they are worried about supply after we get through with whatever this liquidation is going to end up looking like. And so we've seen some packers go in and really take an unsecured role in helping the producer through this rough time, either through debit credit arrangements or marketing arrangements that somehow take some of the market risk out of it. And we think that that's probably a sign of what the future is going to look like as we go through here. And when we think, well, where's the industry headed? Financing. Is financing going to change? I think financing, or at least the way the banking community, and I'm sure we'll hear from them a little later, how they look at the loan portfolio. We are going to continue, as I think in the financing side, to try to take market risk out of the equation and put the onus on production risk. I think in genetics, I think because of what's going on upstream with the packers doing more and more value added, more and more further processing, more and more cooking, that I think that the packer's going to play a lot larger role in helping the producer decide what's best for that particular plant or that particular product. And price discovery, that's my favorite discussion, because I often thought, if I had a hog buyer that worked for me, how would I evaluate him? And I can honestly tell you that I have no idea how you do that. We have live hog mandatory pricing. It's inconsistent, I think. You know, we have one producer that sells about 50 loads of hogs. He sells it one day of the week, and that has a dramatic effect on the market on that particular day. And So maybe that's not the greatest price discovery. And then we got the fatometer, the autofarm, back fat measurement, weight, ultrasound, matrix, and what's the base price? Well, we have one low base price and a high premium, the other is a high base price and a low premium. We have different rate grids subject to change. So it's difficult, I think, to really know exactly what's going on. So I think you look at it as a gross figure, number one. Number two is, I think that it's going to be packer specific, and it's going to be area specific. We're not going to, because we're going to have to take costs out of the system, to think that, a producer can make a deal with a packer that's 600 miles away and the lease cost, it's not going to happen. It's not sustainable. And then we also have the meat-based pricing, and Steve alluded to that earlier, and I've got it on one of the charts. If you look at the blue sheet, first of all, it's not mandatory. The cattle people have done a good job with the boxed beef cutout because it is mandatory. Two loads can change that, and a lot of times there are no loads reported in them. Price will stay the same for 3 or 4 days, be it high or low. And any export business, which basically is 20% of our industry, isn't reflected on the blue sheet. And that's usually the sales that most packers are the proudest of. So I don't think the blue sheet is as credible as it used to be as far as really what's going on in the world, especially as you consider these packers are going upstream and doing more and more further processing. So a lot of the primal cuts are transferred internally, and it really doesn't affect the P&L at that point. And another thing which has kind of been separated from the blue sheet of the number two cutout is the fact that we have offal items or below-the-line items such as grease, which today is 25 cents, and ears, which are $1.25 a pound, and stomachs and tongues are over a dollar, and loins are 90 cents. So we're really not, if we look at the blue sheet, we're not really seeing the total value situation in a pig. You know, once I said that, and Tom alluded to this, and Steve did, and I'm sure Tom will too, but we look at this corn use for ethanol, and it's definitely with us to say. Next slide. And as we said, the perfect storm, that yellow circle to the right, that's the last recession. And boy, it hit a perfect time when we had too many supplies and H1N1 and all that other business. And this is the, which we talked about earlier, is the production trend. Probably the 2009 number is even greater than that because of the circle situation, the cool summer. And one of the things that we had last year that we probably don't have this year is we had a very high-quality feed crop and with high test weights, and this year may look a little different. Now, we think that, and this we did this analysis in October of this year, and we were still anticipating that the sow liquidation would continue for the next 3 months to the tune of about 250,000 sows. Now, that has really slowed down, so this slide may be a little aggressive. But we think that for however it happens, and maybe the speed won't happen, but we're going to look at a pork supply change in 2010 or 2011 that's pretty big. This mountain here, Steve had a chart on earlier that said on an average Iowa style farm that the per head loss was on a single pig basis. The one thing that usually happens, which we kind of tried to wait a little bit, is you normally sell more hogs at a lower market than you do at a higher market. That's why the market's higher. So we think we have taken just, and this is a packer looks at this and says, my God, if my producer's in trouble, I'm in trouble long term. So that's going to change the way they look at contracts. That's the way they're going to change the way they look at relationships. If we're right about the fact, and eventually it will happen, and Tom alluded to it, we need to take butcher kill down. Right now we have FIS slaughter capacity in the meat industry of around 118 million animals per year. And we are going to take capacity utilization in these packing plants down to below 90%. We're going to lose a plant or two. in the next 2 years because they won't operate at 87% and be successful. Now, here's the brightest picture that I know. Number one is currently we have a weak dollar, very weak. If you think about it, $25 or $20 negative margins in hogs, and that means that our product is underpriced below the cost of production. We think exports will surge. We think that China will be back in for a certain amount of product. But the problem is, it's kind of like, do you want to get in the back seat with me, is we don't want to be enamored by the fact that this might just be a 1 or 2 month or 3 month situation, because if we do have a stronger dollar and if we do raise prices up $30 a head, will that demand still be there? It will probably still be there to an extent, but it won't be to the extent it is today. And exports are so important to us because we're going to probably buy between 18 and 20% of every pig that you bring to the slaughterhouse goes out of this country. And it's our most profitable market, and it's the market that we need to protect. And those customers are going to do the same thing with the packers, there's ractopamine issues, there's antibiotic issues, and one thing or another. That's why I think as you talk to your packer, you guys are going to become a lot closer partners in the future. Risk management, we're probably going to use this tool more. I think that the financial institutions are going to make us use it, and I think that the packers are going to offer more and more availability of the fact that they will carry the margin cost and just to make sure that they have a supply. Marketing, I think that the marketing agreements of the future are going to be more geared toward cost of production. I think that they're going to put the onus on the producer to suffer production risk, but I think they're going to share or underpin the market risk. I think they're going to have to do that in order for the financing to happen going forward. And we're going to have we've got competitive meats that bother us. And one thing that Steve brought up is the poultry and industry, and the trouble is those guys can adjust real fast. But I think we have bought, usually low prices take care of low prices, and I think we have built some good demand for our products. And the great thing about the swine industry compared to cattle is that about 65% of that pig can be further processed into different products. So, and the strategic alliance section is, I think that the packer is definitely your partner. I think sometimes we look at them, it's just because they're the ones that are the contact point with price, but I think that we will see the production side of the world and the packer side of the world get much more involved with each other's business. And there's some wisdoms: if you always do what you always done, you always get what you always got. And the last one is, if we don't turn around now, we may just get to where we're going. We need to liquidate more sows to make this industry profitable. I'm not saying that from a pioneer's perspective. I'm just saying that I think we're going to continue with productivity gains, and we have to be careful that we just don't run out total equity. So I don't know how it's done, and I don't know who does it, and I know everyone looks at it as a last man standing, but somehow we have to reduce our sow herd.